channel 5-Minute Economics, where I teach economic concepts in a span of just 5 minutes. Well, today is the part 4 of the ongoing demand series, and in today's video, the topic is why is the demand curve negatively sloping? So in this video, I'll be discussing all the points which lead to the negatively inclined shape of the demand curve. So yeah, let's get started. Also guys, don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel in case you haven't already, and do follow me on Instagram on my handle 5-Minute Economics. So guys, before I begin with the reasons of the negatively inclined shape of the demand curve, well, few of you might not know the shape of the demand curve, so I thought to just show it to you once. So this is our demand curve, where we have demand on the x-axis and price on the y-axis. I've labeled it, and this red line is our demand curve, which is DD. It is negatively inclined, as you can clearly see, from left to right. So that is the shape, and now I'll be telling you why is the shape like that. So guys, let us see why is the demand curve negatively sloping. Number one and most important cause is law of DMU, which is the law of diminishing marginal utility. Well, I'll read all that I have written on the board, but before that, let me give you a very simple example. Supposingly, I'm on a trip with my girls and I'm very hungry and we're all looking for a restaurant, and all of a sudden we see McDonald's. After seeing McDonald's, we all enter into it and I am like, even if the burger is for 1,000 rupees, I am going to order because I'm that hungry. Now I have that burger, that first burger which I have, the first bite which I have is giving me immense satisfaction, right? I was even ready to shell 1,000 rupees for it. Now, since my hunger is satisfied, the second burger, I wouldn't want to have it for 1,000 rupees. Now again, 1,000 rupees for one burger, I will feel, okay, maybe I can wait a little and explore some other restaurants. Or maybe if I get a cheaper burger, maybe, you know, the lesser priced one, maybe for 600 or 700, then it's okay. So what happens is, when I have the second burger, it is not giving me that much satisfaction. Why? Because my hunger is already satisfied. And when I have the second burger, after that, if I'm asking, if my friend asks me, you know, if you want to have the third burger, I will be not ready to have it. Or maybe if it's at a lower price, I might be ready to have it, but definitely not at 1,000 rupees. So this is what exactly law of DMU is, that as we have more of a commodity, the, you know, satisfaction derived from every additional unit keeps on decreasing. So this is what it is actually. With the increase in consumption, every additional unit gives him lesser and lesser satisfaction. As the consumer consumes a commodity in excess, the utility derived from every successive unit keeps on declining. A rational, okay, now we have to speak about rational person, or maybe that person in economics is also known as a utility maximizing consumer, will always try to equalize the utility derived from its price. So he will purchase more units of a commodity only at a lower price, right? That's what I said, that maybe if the burger is available at a lower price, I would want to have the second burger, but definitely not 1,000 rupees. Again, I want to shell on that one burger. So because I'm rational, I'm going to spend less on my second purchase. So that is what happens, is a rational consumer will try to equalize his utility with the price, and in doing so, he will only demand more at a lower price, and hence the demand curve slopes downward from left to right. Well, I've also made a specific video for the topic law of diminishing marginal utility. I'll attach its link over there so you can have a view of that as well. So now guys, coming to the other two causes of the negatively sloping shape of the demand curve. Number one being income effect. Now what is income effect? The change in demand on account of change in real income due to the change in the price is known as income effect. Are you confused? Well, hold on, I'll explain to you. What is real income? Basically, real income is the purchasing power, or basically, you know, the amount of bundle of goods our income can purchase. I'll give you an example. Supposingly I'm earning 10,000 a month, okay? And in that, 5,000 is the amount I spend on food grains, like, you know, wheat, rice, dal, all of that I go and buy for 5,000. Now, supposingly the price of these things falls, you know, supposingly wheat, rice, due to some XYZ reason, now they become cheaper. Now that same 10,000 money of my income is now become more. How has it become more? The real income has risen. The income is 10,000 only, but because now the prices of the commodity has fallen, so now I have more purchasing power. Supposedly I was spending 5,000, now all those things which I was buying in 5,000, I can buy it in 4,000. So that 1,000 I can save or either use it for some other things. So this is the thing. So when the price of the commodities fall, income enables a person to purchase the same amount and save a part of his income. So this is the reason why our negatively sloping shape of the demand curve is. Secondly, substitution effect. Now what is substitution effect? The substitution effect is the effect that a change in the relative price of the substitute good has on the quantity demanded. So by now I assume you all know what the substitute good is. For example, Pepsi and Coca-Cola. Or no, Pepsi is way too sweet. Let's take Coca-Cola and thumbs up. Now, supposedly the prices of thumbs up has fallen. Now, price of thumbs up has fallen, price of Coca-Cola remains same. But in comparison, now Coca-Cola has become expensive and thumbs up has become cheaper. Why? Because ek ke price girne se, the other becomes costlier because they are substitutes for each other. So when the price of the commodity falls, price of the substitute is unchanged, it becomes relatively cheaper in comparison to other commodities and hence its demand rises. So these are the two reasons for the negatively sloping together. Together, income and substitution effect totally are called as the price effect. So lastly, coming to the other two points leading to the negatively sloping shape of the demand curve. Well, increase in the number of consumers. When the price of any commodity is very high, very few people can afford it, isn't it? But when the price of the commodity falls, it becomes very affordable and the number of consumers increase, leading to the negatively sloping shape of the demand curve. For example, airfares, you know, flight tickets, you know, traveling by flight few years back might be just a luxury. We all used to mostly travel by trains, isn't it? But now most of us prefer the flights because airfares have reduced from previous times, right? So that is the reason now it's become more affordable, number of consumers has risen, and the negatively sloping of the demand curve justifies this. Lastly, several uses of a commodity. Now, some goods have only a particular use, whereas there are some goods which are used for many purposes. For example, let us take whiteboard markers. Now, these markers are solely and wholly used to write on the whiteboard, right? Now, even if the price of this rises, I will need to buy it because I have to write it on my board. And even if the price of this falls, I'm not going to hoard them because they are only used to write on the whiteboard. So actually, it has no effect on the demand. But there are some commodities, for example, milk. You know, milk is used for making tea, for making coffee, for just drinking like cold coffee, for, you know, sweets and ice creams, and milk has several purposes. So as the price of milk falls, you know, the demand rises. And whereas when the price of milk rises, the demand falls. And that is the reason which justifies the shape of the demand curve. Now, these are all, guys, the negatively sloping shape of the demand curve, the causes for those. Thank you so much for watching this video. In my next video of the demand series, I'll be coming up with the exceptions to the law of demand. So stay tuned till then, and I'll see you in the next video.